Hi there. This is an animated analogy explaining how conjugate vertical eye movement occurs and how this can get damaged to cause different conjugate vertical gaze palsies. For clarification, conjugate means when both eyes are moving in the same direction and speed. Before discussing how vertical gaze palsies occur in disorders like progressive supranuclear palsy or dorsal midbrain syndrome, we will first cover the main structures that help control vertical gaze and how they can get damaged. The vertical gaze control centers are found between the thalamus and midbrain in an area known as the thalamomesencephalic junction. This is separate from the horizontal gaze control centers, which are found in the pons. Compared to horizontal eye movements, the pathways that control vertical eye movements are much more complex. In part, this is because making both eyes look up or look down requires four extraocular muscles to be activated together, whereas making both eyes look left or right only requires two extraocular muscles to be activated together. Because of this, the analogy has been simplified, with its primary goal being to help you to localize where lesions might occur in the vertical gaze pathway in different pathologies. Because of this simplification, the analogy will not cover torsional eye movements, vestibular inputs to the midbrain controlling the vestibular ocular reflex, or the detailed connections between various thalamomesencephalic structures. Attempts were made to include all of these, but it led to an overly complicated analogy. When we decide that we want to make a vertical saccadic movement, both frontal eye fields must be activated. For vertical smooth pursuit movement, both parietal and occipital eye fields must be activated. Conceptually, this makes sense as looking up and down requires both cerebral hemispheres to be active. The eye fields are not shown in this analogy. Impulses for initiating vertical eye movements travel from the eye fields bilaterally to structures in the thalamomesencephalic junction. Here, there are a number of important structures that control vertical gaze. The most important of these is the rostral interstitial nucleus of the medial longitudinal fasciculus, the interstitial nucleus of Cajal, and the posterior commissure. We will look at each of these in turn. The rostral interstitial nucleus of the medial longitudinal fasciculus, or RIMLF for short, is the main structure controlling vertical and torsional saccadic movement. Its action is analogous to the paramedian pontine reticular formation that controls horizontal saccadic movement. We have a RIMLF on either side of the midbrain, which sends fibers that innervate the nuclei of the various vertical acting extraocular muscles. Each RIMLF contains upgaze and downgaze saccadic fibers. The upgaze saccadic fibers innervate the superior rectus and the inferior obliques of nuclei bilaterally. This is represented by the large red handle indicating bilateral innervation to the elevating eye muscle subnuclei. The downgaze saccadic fibers supply the inferior rectus and superior obliques of nuclei ipsilaterally. This is shown by the smaller orange handle indicating ipsilateral innervation to depressing eye muscle subnuclei. Reiterated, this means that each side's RIMLF gives bilateral input to quickly look up, but only ipsilateral input to quickly look down. As an aside, the pathway from the superior rectus subnuclei and the trochlear nuclei to the corresponding extraocular muscles is crossed. For example, the right superior rectus subnucleus of the right ocular motor nucleus supplies the left superior rectus, and the right trochlear nucleus supplies the left superior oblique. In short, the superior named extraocular muscles are supplied by nuclei from the opposite side of the brainstem. Because of this crossing over, it will lead to an overly complicated analogy if the pathways from the subnuclei to the muscles were included. Consequently, this has been simplified to the grey bar, where the bottom of the bar can be imagined to represent muscles that depress the eye, and the top of the bar represents muscles that elevate the eye. Interestingly, the RIMLF does not atrophy over time. This means that vertical saccadic eye movement should always remain fast throughout your life. So if slowing of vertical saccades does occur, this means that there must be a lesion affecting the RIMLF. This is what happens in progressive supranuclear palsy and will be discussed later. The interstitial nucleus of Cajal, or INC for short, is the main structure to allow for vertical and torsional gaze holding and vertical smooth pursuit. This means it can keep the eyes in an up or down position if needed and helps you track a vertically moving target. Anatomically, this lies just below the RIMLF. The INC is also called the neural integrator, as it combines information from other structures, such as the vestibular nuclei and the RIMLF, which the INC then computes to hold the eyes in an up or down position. As the INC receives input from the vestibular nuclei, it also helps control the vestibular ocular reflex, or VOR for short, in the vertical plane. Each side's INC sends fibers that go to the opposite side's INC. It also innervates vertically acting extraocular muscle nuclei ipsilaterally and contralaterally. This means it can coordinate eye movement bilaterally. This is shown in the analogy by the blue poles with the lift-elevator mechanism attached to the grey bar. The INC controls how far up and how far down you can see, which we will refer to as the vertical range of motion. This is shown by the blue boards, with the bottom blue board showing how far the eyes can look down, and the top blue board showing how far the eyes can look up. The spring attaching the balls together is not an anatomical structure, but its purpose will make sense when we talk about INC pathologies. As an aside, although the INC supply upward and downward eye movement, it is believed that the INC gives stronger ipsilateral input to the depressor eye muscle subnuclei. This will become relevant when discussing pathologies such as dorsal midbrain syndrome, also known as Parinaud syndrome. The posterior commissure, or PC for short, is a myelinated tract that is found posteriorly, also called dorsally, in the midbrain. It plays an important role in connecting different structures of the left and right midbrain with each other. For example, it is involved in the pupillary light reflex to help connect the pretectal nucleus with the contralateral Edingo-Westphal nucleus. In regards to vertical gaze, the PC acts as a bridge to help the INCs communicate with each other and the contralateral extraocular muscle subnuclei. Highlighted is the nucleus of the PC, which is found in the PC and has fibers that go to the RIMLF and INC. The nucleus of the PC is thought to help with upgaze movement. This is represented by the green ball, with its upgaze fiber projections represented by the green board connected by a stretched green rubber band. The thin and stretched appearance of the green rubber band signifies that the green board is heavy in weight. To simplify the analogy, the INC connections passing through the PC and the nucleus of the PC fibers going to the RIMLF and INC are not shown. In a normal person, if they are asked to quickly look at an object held above them, shown by the red ball, then both the frontal eye fields will activate both the right and left RIMLF upgaze saccadic fibers, which activates the elevating eye muscle subnuclei, so that the eyes make an upward saccadic movement. This is shown by both the red handles representing the RIMLF upgaze fibers pulling the grey bar on either side up, which moves the eyes up. If the person is then asked to quickly look down at an object below them, this time the bilateral RIMLF downgaze fibers are activated to make a downward saccadic movement. This is shown by the smaller orange handles, representing the RIMLF downgaze fibers pulling the eyes down. For analogy purposes, the saccadic eye movements have been slowed down. If the person is now asked to follow a vertically moving target, this time the INCs help the eyes make smooth pursuit movement to follow the target. This is shown by the blue lift elevator mechanism smoothly moving the grey bar up and down so that eyes can track the red ball. This operates independently from the RIMLF, even though in the analogy it seems that the handles are moving the eyes up and down. Another way to test the INCs is by performing the vestibular ocular reflex in the vertical plane, or vertical VOR for short. To test this, you hold either side of the person's head with your hands and ask them to focus on your nose. If you move their head down, their eyes will reflexively move upward, but to the view of you as the examiner, their eyes will appear to stay in the same place. Their eyes always move opposite to the direction of head movement, so that you can continue to fixate on an object even when your head is moving. If the patient's head is now moved up, their eyes reflexively move down so that they can continue to focus on the examiner's nose. By testing the vertical VOR, you are checking that the INCs are working normally, as the eyes can move smoothly without any restriction of vertical movement. Just to reiterate again, the purpose of this analogy is not to show all the anatomical connections between various vertical gaze centers. Rather, the analogy was created to help you at the bedside so that when you assess a patient with a possible vertical gaze palsy, you would be able to localize which foramen mesencephalic structures might be damaged. Lesions that affect structures at the foramen-mesencephalic junction most commonly are caused by strokes, but inflammatory lesions are also possible. To recap, the RIMLF controls vertical saccadic eye movement. Let's imagine we have a lesion shown by the scissors, which damages the left RIMLF. If the patient is then asked to quickly look up at the red ball, there should be normal upward saccadic movement. This is because the elevating eye muscle subnuclei receive bilateral input from both RIMLFs, and so if the left RIMLF is damaged, the right RIMLF can take over to help elevate both eyes. This is shown in the analogy by the larger right-red handle being strong enough to lift the grey bar to elevate both eyes. However, if this patient is then asked to quickly look down, they may either have slowed down, little or no downward saccadic eye movement. This is because the RIMLF only gives ipsilateral input to depressor eye muscle subnuclei. As the left RIMLF has gone, the right RIMLF will not be able to depress both eyes by itself. This is shown by the right small orange handle being too small to be strong enough to move the grey bar down, resulting in little to no downward eye movement. In summary, unilateral RIMLF lesions typically lead to downgaze saccadic palsy. Now, if both RIMLFs are completely damaged, there will be both upgaze and downgaze saccadic palsies, as seen by no eye movements when asked to quickly look up or down. Occasionally, there may be worsening downgaze saccadic palsy compared to upgaze saccadic palsy, as there are other foramen mesencephalic structures such as the nucleus of the PC, which if unaffected, can help aid saccadic upgaze movement. As the INCs are unaffected, vertical smooth pursuit should be normal as seen by the normal tracking of the red ball. If this patient's vertical VOR is tested, this will be normal as the INC is not damaged. Regarding RIMLF pathologies, bilateral RIMLF lesions in general are more common than unilateral RIMLF lesions. Interestingly, in 20% of people, both RIMLFs are supplied by a single phlegmic vessel known as the artery of Pierson. In these patients, an artery of Pierson stroke will lead to bilateral RIMLF damage among other midbrain and phlegmic signs. In summary, bilateral RIMLF lesions may cause either total vertical saccadic palsy or downward more than upward saccadic palsy. Progressive supranuclear palsy, or PSP for short, is an atypical Parkinsonian disorder where abnormal tau proteins deposit in various brain structures. This includes the RIMLF, where one of the most earliest and most sensitive signs of PSP is slowing of vertical saccades due to bilateral RIMLF degeneration. The bilateral RIMLF degeneration is represented by the RIMLF red and orange handles becoming smaller and lighter in color, as well as vertical saccadic slowing. When asking a PSP patient to quickly look up or down, the eyes may take a curved path rather than moving straight down. This is known as round the houses sign due to the additional horizontal saccadic component creating the curved eye movement orbiting around its own house center. Importantly, when suspecting PSP, it is vital to check vertical saccadic movement and not just vertical smooth pursuit. This is because early on in the disease process, the INCs may not be affected, and so if you just test vertical smooth pursuit, there may be no abnormality seen. Later on, however, during the disease process, there may be restriction of vertical gaze due to bilateral INC involvement. To recap, the INCs control vertical gaze holding, vertical smooth pursuit, and vertical VOR. If a unilateral INC lesion occurs, this will impair vertical gaze holding function, but not restrict vertical range of motion or vertical VOR. And so, if the RIMLF creates a downward saccadic movement, the eyes will drift back to the center, as the INCs cannot hold the eyes in that down gaze position. This has not been shown in the analogy. If both the INCs are damaged, this will impair vertical gaze holding, vertical smooth pursuit, and vertical VOR. If there is partial bilateral INC lesions, this will partly restrict all INC functions. This is shown by part of the blue poles, including the lift elevator mechanism being removed, which represents partial bilateral INC damage. This causes the two blue boards to move closer together due to the stored tension in the spring. The moving of the two blue boards closer together represent that the vertical range of motion has been reduced because the INCs are partially damaged. This means that when a vertical saccadic eye movement is tested, there will be normal upward and downward saccadic eye movement as the RIMLFs are unaffected, but how far the eyes can move will be restricted. With complete bilateral INC lesions, there will be no vertical eye movement as the vertical range of motion is severely restricted. This is shown by the blue poles being removed, which releases the stored tension from the spring, connecting the blue boards and clamps down on the eye, preventing it from moving up or down. If a vertical saccadic movement is attempted, there will be no movement seen, as the vertical range of motion has gone due to the complete bilateral INC damage. If vertical VOR is tested, again, there will be no movement due to bilateral INC damage. To recap, the PC holds connections from the INCs to help it communicate with each other and the contralateral extraocular muscle subnuclei. Because of this, there is a lot of similarity clinically between bilateral INC lesions and PC lesions. Saying this, there is a tendency for PC lesions to cause upgaze palsies more than downgaze palsies. The reason for this is threefold. Firstly, as previously mentioned, the nucleus of the PC has fibers that go to the RIMLF and INC to help with upgaze, and so a nucleus or PC lesion will cause an upgaze palsy. Secondly, the INC also sends ipsilateral fibers to the eye muscle nuclei which do not pass through the PC. Of these ipsilateral fibers, the INC gives stronger ipsilateral projections to downgaze eye muscle nuclei. This means that if a PC lesion occurs, the ipsilateral INC downgaze fibers are not affected, and so downgaze movement is okay. Thirdly, it is believed that the contralaterally passing INC upgaze fibers running in the PC are more posteriorly placed compared to the contralaterally passing INC downgaze fibers. And so, in an expanding posterior lesion compressing the PC, upgaze is affected first. This is shown by the purple posterior lesion that is expanding. It damages the green ball representing the nucleus of the PC, which causes the green rubber band and board to fall down. The green rubber band appears thicker as it is released from having to carry the weight of the green board. The green rubber band then attaches onto the top blue board. This is only for analogy purposes. The resting or the heavy green board on the pupil signifies restriction of voluntary upward eye movement. If he asks his patient to quickly look up, the RIMLFs will not be able to create an upward saccadic movement. This is shown by the unsuccessful attempt to pull both red handles up, but this cannot lift the grey bar up as it is weighed down by the heavy green board. If then asked to quickly look down, this movement is fine, as seen by the orange handles pulling the grey bar down. The green board does not move down as it is attached to the top blue board. When the vertical VOR is tested, this is unaffected. This is because the PC lesion does not damage the INC themselves, and so vestibular inputs to the INC are unaffected. The lift mechanism on the blue poles is strong enough to lift the grey bar against the heavy green board. This can be easily imagined, as elevators can normally carry weight as much as 1 ton. PC lesions can cause dorsal midbrain syndrome. This is also known as pyranoid syndrome. In this, an upgaze palsy with an intact vertical VOR is a classical finding. Downgaze palsy can additionally occur, but this tends to occur later on in the disease process. There are other features of dorsal midbrain syndrome, such as convergence retraction nystagmus-like movement, bilateral lid retraction, and light and ear dissociation, but they are beyond the scope of this specific analogy. In summary, vertical saccadic eye movement is controlled by the RIMLF, for which there is bilateral innervation for upward saccades. Vertical pursuit, gaze holding, and vertical VOR are controlled by the INC. The PC helps the INC connect to structures on the opposite side, with the nucleus of the PC additionally helping the RIMLF and INC with upward movement. Unilateral RIMLF lesions cause downgaze saccadic palsy, and bilateral RIMLF lesions can cause either total vertical saccadic palsy or downgaze more than upgaze saccadic palsy. This is a common finding in PSP. Unilateral INC lesions cause issues with gaze holding, whereas bilateral INC lesions can cause varying levels of gaze holding, vertical range of motion, and vertical VOR abnormalities. PC lesions are similar to bilateral INC lesions, as the PC carries INC fibers, but tend to cause upgaze palsy due to damage to the nucleus of the PC without affecting VOR. This is a common finding in the collection of signs seen in dorsal midbrain syndrome.